marriage, love and marriage go together like a horse and carriage. This I tell you, brother, you can't have one without the other.
We're calling this the good, the bad, and the ugly. So we're going to talk about our story, the good and bad. And I'm Dr. George Elson Jr. This is my beautiful wife, Dr. Kimberly Johnson. So we just want to tell you a little bit about our story. Our story begins as we were best friends. And we actually dated in college for about a little while. And
I was in high school.
She was in high school. Don't tell people that. You know, you never know.
I was a senior. Ooh.
Age. Robbing the cradle. Oh, my God. Was that illegal? No, she was older. She's older than me, y'all. No, I'm just
kidding. I am not. I've always been
But our story started in 1995, actually. And I made a series of bad decisions that a lot of people don't understand. That I'm actually a college flunk out. I flunked out of college. I tell people that all the time. There's a difference between dropping out and flunking out. You know, when you drop out, you make the decision.
You withdraw.
I don't want to come back here. This is not working. I'm moving on. But when you flunk out,
they tell you to go.
Don't come back. You don't have what it takes to make it here. So I flunked out of college. I was working a dead end job as an overnight cashier at a place called Food Max. And I don't even know if that place is still open, but it was right there in Alabaster, Alabama. And I never forget the day I got the letter that I had flunked out of college. They told me I had to leave the dorm. And I was actually homeless for a while. And what I mean by homeless is I could actually always go back home. You know, I go back home to mama's house. But I've been on my own since I was 18 years old. So, you know, who wants to go back to mama's house, you know? But I was actually homeless for a while. What I mean by that is I'm sleeping from couch to couch over this person's house. My homeboy house, but I was still dating her, and she would. Did you know I was homeless?
No, I didn't know.
You didn't know I was homeless. I had lost my apartment due to a series of bad decisions, and so I was living. What I mean by homeless, I'm talking about living from couch to couch. So I'll stay in this person's dorm room for a night, and then I'll stay in this person's dorm room for a night. The reason I was doing that is because I was actually trying to get back into college. Mm-hmm. Because what happened, I had made I got all these incompletes. And I was trying to, I said, well, if I can just get the scores back, you know, at least they'll let me in.
And if I hang out with these guys.
We were hanging out too, but I was really trying to get back into school.
See, if he had told me, I just would have gave him a solid game plan.
So when we say homeless, I wasn't homeless in the place of living on the street homeless, but I was living from couch to couch, trying to go back to school. Mm-hmm. And my wife and I, we talking long distance over the phone, you know, collect. She had all the good credit and all the good cards. So what I would do is I would call and say, hey, hang up, we'll hang up. She'll call me right back. And so we were talking to her. But there's the thing, and that one of my lowest points at that point in my life, mm-hmm. you were just those conversations. I look forward to those conversations and mm-hmm. us talking and me lying, you know. Well, all this wonderful stuff, you know, that I was doing, and I really wasn't.
You was doing so good in school.
I was doing so good in school.
So good in school.
So anyway, to make a long story short, no, it's not going to be a long story short because I really want to get into everything that we've had to overcome. So I'm working this dead-end job at night. I'm homeless. I'm sleeping from couch to couch. But Kim stayed with me. She always would tell me, honey, I see more in you.
I see greatness in you.
She would always say that. And from time to time, she said, you're my motivational speaker. I see greatness in you. So she believed in me. Why do I want to say that? I want to say that because sometimes you want to be with somebody that can see greatness in you mm-hmm. when you can't see it in yourself. Because sometimes it's hard to see the picture of greatness on your life when you're in the frame.
Yeah, that's true.
It's hard to see it. So you have to align yourself sometimes with a woman or with a man that's going to not magnify your flaws, but magnify your greatness.
It's going to speak life.
So I wonder sometimes that even though I was going through all that, did you know I was going through that? Or was you just, I mean, did you know I was homeless? Did you, I mean, you knew I was, you know, he was broke because, you know,
yeah. I was a college student.
I could never take her on a date. She always wanted to go on a date. And I couldn't take her on a date because I didn't have any money to take her on a date. So what we would do is
we wanted to go to a restaurant.
We would house hop.
So we'd go like, we'll say, what your mama cook?
What your mama cook? Churches.
You know, right, I remember the first time we actually could go and really buy something beyond churches. It was a little Chinese restaurant. And it was
right there in Five Points West.
I wonder if that restaurant's
still there. We need to go out there one day and tell our children that... Mm. But I'll never forget that, Kim. That was out. We were actually able to go on a date.
The first time he could finally really take me somewhere. It was a Chinese place in Five Points. It was not excluding, you know, when we went to the prom, you took me out for the prom. But it's a Chinese place.
Right.
And then we were so excited.
Oh, my God, man.
And somebody started talking loud up in there. We had to go eat that real quick. Had to go pack it up and leave. It was turning.
But no matter what and how I was, she never talked about where I was. Mm-hmm. We always talked about where we were going.
We always talked about what we saw.
And we would always get in the car, remember?
And ride.
And we would ride and go look at these beautiful, nice homes. And I would say, honey, I'm going to buy your house one day. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. Didn't have anything. College flunk out. Working a dead-end job. So I finally got this letter one day from the office of, records or whatever. And they told me, they said, dear Mr. Justin, I wish I would have kept that letter. I wish I could find it.
It's in your file.
It probably is. But they told me, you can't come back. You flunked out of college. I was at a very low point. And I went to work that night. And I'll never forget, while I was at work that night, I was standing there and nothing was working for me. The only good thing in my life that was working for me was Kim.
It was me.
That was the only good thing working for my life. So I remember, and I said, I came up with this idea. I said, you know what? I'm going to marry Kim. She was the only good thing that I had working for me. So I went to her father at the time, who owned a great business. And I went to him, and I was very serious. And I said, Mr. Yelling, I've been dating your daughter for a while now, and I want to marry your daughter.
We have been dating, what, about 4 years now?
We've been dating about 3 years now. And I'll never forget the wonderful words that poured
from his
lips.
He always had a way with words.
I mean, it spoke volumes to me. It made me really see who I was.
I'm sure it did.
I go to him and I'm very sincere. This is a true story. He was working in his art gallery. I go there one late night. Kim doesn't even know I'm there. I go there. I pop up.
Because I would have told him ahead of time.
Don't do that. Yeah. And I went by there and said, hey, listen, I love your daughter. We've been dating for a while. I want to marry your daughter. And he looked at me and his whole demeanor changed. I mean, he went from, hey, George, to if you don't get the...
Talk about my daddy.
And he looked at me with these eyes, and he said, word for word, hell no, you can't marry my daughter. You don't have nothing.
Yeah, that sounds like something.
And I went from this great man with all this pride and my chest out to, I really felt bad. So I went to work that night, and he told me, you know, that I couldn't marry his daughter. I said, wow, I had flunked out of college. I was working a dead-end job. So I got on the phone and I said, Kim, I love you. We've been together for 3 years now. Will you marry me? And Kim said,
yeah.
Yeah. I said, okay, well, I'll come to Auburn tomorrow and we'll go get married, right? She's like, okay. I said, well, how much does it cost? She said, $35. So I went to the grocery store. I wrote a check over. You know, sometimes you used to be able to write over and get the cash back.
No, they send it right through right
yeah,
now.
Right.
See, back then. We had a couple of days to work. Yeah.
So I took a check and I wrote over. I bought maybe some little whatever.
Ice cream or something.
And I wrote over $35, maybe $40. And I got the $35, $40 back,
mm-hmm.
and we went to the courthouse.
Yeah, in Lee County.
Married. Yeah. I wish it was more romantic than that, but
yeah. Cheapest wedding I ever had.
We actually got wedding gifts from Justice of the Peace.
I thought it was going to be so, you know, heart spoken, and that we were before the judge, and you could tell he had a little highlight on a piece of paper, and he just read. And they gave us some washing powder and asked if we want to have it published in the paper. And we said no. Because we hadn't told our parents.
Nobody knew. Okay, so let me back up and review. Her dad just told me, hell no.
He didn't tell me my daddy said that. He didn't.
My parents, they didn't know. Her parents. So we really actually eloped.
Yeah.
Did you know that that's the definition of eloped?
I know, but it just doesn't.
It doesn't sound like the word
I want to go with my story. So I don't use that word.
We don't use elope. We had...
We just got married.
I wish it was more.
We just got married and didn't tell nobody.
So that's our story. Yeah. That's where our life began. Nobody sat down
living
and talked to me.
Living this thing to the fullest.
Right. Nobody sat down and talked to me about this is what you need to do. This is what you don't need to do. Nobody talked about me these four needs that we talked about: leadership, respect, honor, security, and intimacy. Nobody talked to me about that. I had no clue what I was getting into. So I was in violation of all five of these areas in the first year of our marriage. I was a horrible husband. Not meaning
that. You weren't horrible.
I was horrible.
I don't think you were. Well, you just.
In the way of what we know now.
You needed a little growing up.
What I mean by horrible, no. Don't ever think. I've never been mean to Kim. I've never disrespected her. I never did that. What I mean by horrible is I didn't know how to be a leader.
You didn't know how to be a husband.
I didn't.
You were immature.
I had no idea of what it means for your wife to respect you. I thought respect was fixing my plate because that's what I saw at home, and that's what I said, you got to clean the house. You're supposed to do this. You're supposed to clean up after me. I'm supposed to be able to come in whenever I want to come in, but you got to give me a time when you're coming in. I didn't understand what respect means. I didn't understand that. Mm-hmm. Honor. You know, I didn't understand how to honor your wife and what it means to show true honor and how to be a leader. And the most important was security. But in all of this, again, I'm not trying to put my wife on a pedestal. I'm not trying to do that. I'm trying to prove a point.
You got the part about security. Because we got married. And even though he was working a dead-end job, he was working. Then he was like, I quit. He quit his job.
Let me tell y'all another really funny story.
And then
story.
Went around another not so great one.
But here's, we'll talk about that one next. But let me tell you a very important, I'm going to tell you another. We got stories for days. My wife, she's always been frugal. She's always been able to make ends meet and make things stretch. Anybody ever visit a home, they know my wife, she loves to decorate. Our house is beautiful. If you come, our house is beautiful.
My wife
decorates and different things like that. And she makes things look really beautiful. So when she moved into this apartment on campus, they gave her a huge discount, half of her rent. So
Lord,
if the rent was $350, she only had to pay, what's half of $350?
I don't even want to talk about that story.
But I got to tell her this, $175.
I get upset. So, because my apartment, I kept it so nice, they were going to use it as a show unit.
A show unit, right.
They just, it had to be in pristine condition so they could come and show somebody at any time.
And her house apartment was. But when we got married, for better or for worse, and sickness and in health, although he read it out of the book, we live by these vows. Till death do us part. She had this wonderful discount. So instead of paying $350 a month by her agreeing to allow her house to be
It's been 20 some years.
Having her home open for those 4 hours, I think from 9 to 12, that they could come show it.
I'm disgusted. That was 20 some years ago.
Right. She got a 50% discount on her rent. Should I tell them the story what happened? You want to tell
them? I lost my discount because of the person sitting next
to
me.
She lost her discount because the guy, they didn't tell me they were coming at 9 o'clock. So the people came to show the house.
I forgot. I
at
left
9
early.
O'clock. And
I think he scared off the
I business. Was laying in the bed. Naked with no clothes on.
I don't know about it.
I was naked with no clothes on. And when no people walking there, I screamed and hollered. They screamed.
And I was informed that the discount
was
over.
They took my discount. We got stories for days, guys. We got stories for days.
I had forgotten about that one.
We got stories for days. But I didn't have these five things in place. So I had hit another low point. Mm-hmm. And many of you know my testimony, my story. I actually was contemplating suicide. Because I had hit such a low point in my life. Mm-hmm. I wasn't able to provide for my family. We lost a huge discount. So now we're on the verge of losing everything. I never could keep any of the bills going on in the house. I kept
lying. It was one thing
after another. And when you experience
probably because we didn't
and
plan.
And when you don't have a plan. And nobody's teaching you how to do this.
You just get
how
frustrated.
To do life. The enemy is so unfair. Mm-hmm. He will begin to tell you what you're not. He will begin to tell you how short. He will begin to talk into your ear. And when you hear that over and over and over again, I hit a roadblock in my life where it was just, I said, this is it. Mm-hmm. But supernaturally, God intervened. stopped me from committing such a horrible act and leaving her here on this earth by herself, because he said, if you could see
what I could see,
what I could see. See, at that moment, God saw this great man you see today. God saw that. Kim always saw that. And at that moment when death was imminent and I was just about to do it, God stepped in. Yeah. So what do you want to say? Listen, don't look at your husband or your wife where they are now. Look at where they're going.
Yeah.
And speak life where the enemy has pronounced death.
Mm-hmm.
Always be in their corner. Always be championing them all. No matter how bad the fight may be, always talk life.
Mm-hmm.
So we have moved all that. You want me to tell the story how we passed our first church? Because I'm trying to get to the point of this right here, Spiritual Giants, but it don't look like we're going to get there tonight.
Probably not the part about the first church.
We only have 4 minutes left.
Okay, then you need to get to this point here.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we went through a plethora of things, guys. We have stories.
Oh, yeah, we got stories for days.
And notice I told you, nobody ever told me these five principles: leadership, respect, honor, security, and intimacy. Nobody had told my wife that a man needs sex. A man needs to be respected.
Well, my grandma said one time, she said, man, just be man. I knew what she was talking about.
Did she say that for real?
She did. This is before we got married. Let me talk about my grandma. But anyway.
The first point I wanted to make is this. You can actually be a spiritual giant, but a relational infant.
Yeah.
You can be a spiritual giant, and relationship-wise, you can be an infant. The reason I say that, a lot of times when I know a lot of pastors tune into our broadcast, they may not ever come online, but I know that they come back and they watch them later. You may think that you don't need marital counseling because your ministry possibly could be growing. There was a time in my wife's life, our wife's life, we were leading people to Christ. Our church was booming.
But we could have choked each other at home.
But relationship-wise at home, it was horrible. I mean, I hated to come home. I did. I stayed at the football field all day, working all day, leaving her at home by herself with this newborn baby. It was a point that we just choked. We were not talking to each other.
We were talking at each other.
We were talking at each other. So you can be at the first point that I want to make is that never align yourself with what you do. So many times people say, well, my marriage is going to work because you think your career is working or your job is working or you may be doing these things really, really well. But the only way that you'll know that your relationship is really working
is talk to the people in the house.
Talk to the people in
the house. Talk to your spouse. It's amazing how many people, like you said, they're successful in the ministry or in their careers. But if you ever get the people that they live with, their spouse, to talk, no. That they put time and energy and everything else, but they have not worked on that piece.
And you have to take some time and you have to work on it.
Yes. It's work. Nobody's saying it's easy. It's work.
You work every single day. Mm-hmm. You work at it. And so we were at a point that we were actually spiritual giants. And what I mean by that, on the outside, on the surface, everything looked good.
Mm-hmm. Running to everybody else's rescue.
But at the bottom, it was really, really bad.
We were struggling.
You can be a loving leader, or I put it out here, a loving pastor, but be a mean spouse.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people can
And
have
we've seen this so many times. Not, you know, that people can show so much love to others, but their spouse, some of us are just not, I mean, just mean.
Right.
Mean or not kind or dry or whatever the case may be.
Now I want you to explain this. When you put, you can be superheroes, but intimate victims.
I'm like, okay, what did I mean by that?
What do you mean by that? You put superheroes, I guess, going.
Pretty much just kind of what we said a minute ago. You have to be careful that you're not a superhero to everybody else. That you're running to everybody else's rescue. You're running. Oh, let me give you this example. I always find it interesting when I like to learn and read about people that are successful, right? And so there are people in our society that are successful and you hear about this or they invented this or they did that, but I always want to know, I want to hear from their family.
Right.
Because I think sometimes that people can have the appearance, they can do all these great things or they are superheroes to everybody else. They're running, they're doing this and they're doing that, but the people in their home are suffering.
Right.
Because they haven't made the people in their home a priority.
Right.
And you have to be careful about that, I think, especially in the ministry, because people, the ministry can pull on you, and people will pull on you, and people expect, because you have accepted the mantle of being a pastor or, you know, a minister or the leader, that you got to be always available. And if you don't put up boundaries, you will look up and you're available for everybody else, and your home will be suffering.
Wow.
Your home will be suffering. But that's in anything. You got to make sure that you have your priorities in order.
Wow. Well, guys, that's what we want to basically do. I kind of got caught in my story at the beginning, and we never really made it down to what we really, well, we gave you the points mm-hmm. that we wanted to make tonight. But like I said, at the end of every series, we're going to talk about this. Next week, we're going to talk about remedies to bedroom dysfunction. So that's what we're going to talk about next week.
Well, but, and I think it's really important. You guys might say, well, why did you go through that? I think sometimes in life, especially with social media, we have a tendency to look at other people's lives, look at other people's situations, and think that everything is always together, or they never had a challenge or never had a struggle. And then we get discouraged.
Right.
But if you understand, that's the reason I like when people, at least in the people that I like to listen to, when people will share part of their heart and their testimony, it helps you to understand that, hey, I'm not the only one. It's something about knowing that you're not the only one, that others, because the devil will make you think you're the only one that has ever dealt with a particular issue. Your marriage is the only one that's ever dealt with this, or maybe you in your career, if you're a lady or as a mother or a father, but to know that others have dealt with it and they overcame.
Yeah.
It gives you hope. Gives you hope.
Because, you know, I couldn't say it no better.
I mean, look at him.
Yeah.
He can't look.
A long way. You know the old folks used to say, the Lord brought me a mighty long way.
He done brought me a mighty
I didn't even know that the broadcast was going to take this turn and me actually, because I'm saying in my case, it was my wife. She saw the greatness in me. She saw what I could become. Mm-hmm. And she always talked that. And we never lost vision of what we were trying to go. We had difficult things happen. And we had all this kind of stuff, crazy stuff happen. We did grow apart at one time when, you know, our relationship grew apart. But I never thought that she lost hope and belief mm-hmm. in me. In my situation, it was my wife. Your situation may be different. Your husband may see it in you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? You may feel like, I'm not going anywhere. I'm not doing anything. I'm not done. And it may seem like that there is a dead end, but I'm just here to tell you that if you could see what I could see, just remember that word.
Yeah.
If you could see what I could see, you wouldn't complain. And God saw greatness. My wife saw greatness. So always see the good.
Mm-hmm.
And that's another thing. My wife never amplified the bad stuff. She never talked about the bad stuff. You know, and we it's a lot of lessons. We never talked outside of the house, you know. Yeah. But I wasn't abusive and all that kind of stuff either. But it's a lot of lessons in that. It's
so we'll just keep sharing those over the weeks to come.
It's a lot of lessons in that. So.
And marriage, love and marriage go together like a horse and carriage. This I tell you, brother, you can't have one without the other.